Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to make a pitch for science in transition. Science should change. You heard it already in the introduction. But to make my case, I will take us and you back this morning to 1986, the beginning of the AIDS epidemic. The AIDS epidemic was a devastating new infection. Many gay people, many gay men in New York, San Francisco, but also in Amsterdam, saw their friends dying. There was no cure. Nothing could be done. And what they saw, that there was a lot of money being put into the system to do scientific research. But they felt that these scientists were playing their own game. They were even quarreling about who discovered the virus, who is getting the Nobel Prize. And they were in the streets, and you could see it on the slides behind me. They were on the streets and saying, you guys have to act up. We have to fight the disease, not each other. And what are you doing in these laboratories? Are you making a cure or are you making a career? They were really, really mad. And this was the first time when patients spoke up. And patients went to the White House to yell at the president and to yell at Tony Fauci, which I know very well, from the National Institute of Health in the United States. Do something. Let us in. Talk with us about what should be done about this devastating disease. Our friends are dying. In Amsterdam, I was part, as a young, very young scientist, I was part of a group of people, scientists, fighting the AIDS epidemic. We were setting up a large cohort, the Amsterdam cohort on HIV and AIDS, and we studied, with the help of the participants, gay men, we studied the disease. These people came every 3 months to give blood, to fill in questionnaires, and they were very open and honest with us. And in return, we organized on one of the canals, in a small theater, we organized sessions where we explained to them what type of research we were doing. And imagine, I was very young in those days and very innocent. So I gave my talk about how T cells were dying in HIV-infected patients and how this was fascinating for science. And it also got me a paper into Science, a very high-ranking journal. And I saw in the eyes of these guys that, they were all guys, of course, I was seeing in the eyes of these guys, this is not what we want. This guy there in front, this Miedema guy, he is not doing what we want. And I got a very insecure feeling. And then at one point in time, one of those young men, he came to the microphone and he said, lovely, yeah, interesting, but my friend and I, we are both seropositive. Can we have unprotected sex? That's my question. At that point in time, I realized there was a disconnect. His question was extremely important, because is it dangerous to become reinfected? Can those viruses mingle? And are these more dangerous viruses coming out? We didn't know. That was a question in my laboratory nobody had dreamed of, nobody had thought of. We were thinking about T cells and getting a paper into Science. That was my moment of sort of seeing what was really going on. Why these stories? I tell you these stories because what we found out, what ACT UP was finding out, and what Tony Fauci in the United States was finding out, was that there was a disconnect. That in fact, I found out I was in the science circle, but society was someplace else. And my patients, the patients we studied and we collaborated with, they were in another domain of society. And this was really a shocking, of course, sensation. And my pitch is that science should be put back in society, it must be put back in the context to be really of value for what it was really meant for the world, for the good life. Of course, now HIV and AIDS is under control, at least in the developing countries, in the developed world. But we have other grand challenges like climate change, food for everybody, welfare and public health for everybody, not only everywhere on the globe, but also sustainable and affordable. We have to think about institutions. We have to think about democracy. We have to think about what should government do. And we need a lot of science for all these grand challenges to help us to move and to have progress in society. And I plea and I pledge with you that science is our best hope to make that change and to make that progress. So don't look away from science, but put it in the context. Are scientists not aware? Don't they know where these big problems are? I truly believe and I know that most of the scientists, virtually, know where the big questions are. But apparently, they are not rewarded to take on that type of difficult questions. To think about that a little bit more, we have to think, how come? Why are these scientists not doing that type of research that we are all dying for? We really want that information. And therefore, we have to think a little bit about how science really works. Most of you think about science as geniuses, extremely clever people, not like you and me. People that are picking up and taking on extremely difficult questions to think about black holes and Higgs bosons and the mysteries of nature and life. And they have their own questions, they have their own domain, and they have their own world. And that's because they are so extremely clever. We couldn't even dream to think about what they are thinking about. And sometimes, sort of by accident, serendipity, people use that word, sometimes by accident, something useful is coming out. In most cases, years after these inventions and discoveries have been made. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a hopelessly outdated and romantic view. If it was ever so, it is not what science is about at all in these days that we live in now. Think about this. Take a picture of money and many people doing science. Science is extremely capital intensive. Having a laboratory studying HIV, it takes millions per year to do it, to be competitive, to be able to buy the machines you really need to do your research. And this is not only for life science, but also for other sciences. And science has become increasingly big. So it has become a large system. It's not only a few very genius people. No, there are many people now in science. And science has grown. And because of that, there's an enormous amount of hyper-competition. People are fighting for money. Because money is scarce, there's more researchers coming into the system, and we are in a strong competition. And this has really changed the soul of science. Really. Imagine 80 to 90% of the people that do science now, 80 to 90% of the science that is being reported and published now is being done now. So all this work is being done in our lifetime. 80 to 90% of everything that has been done in science is happening now. Imagine how big that system has grown. And then, of course, there's the problem. How then do you decide who to give the money? Who are the clever people who deserve the money for their research? And then, of course, this is being dealt with by management. And management is mainly done by numbers. So people have started in the past 30 years to distribute the money based on number of publications that a scientist is producing, or citations that somebody gets, or the prestige of a journal that he or she publishes in. And also, we have been used to a system where 4 years is about the time that a subsidy or a funding is being handed out. So every 4 years, you have to go in the competition to get your next round of money for your next round of research. And so we are counting all these publications, and everybody is making publications because this is what your career is all about. This is the way to survive in science. So what do you think you get? An enormous amount of publications. 1.3 million in 2006. And it's growing. This is an overwhelming amount of publications. There's even more publications than you can read and can even oversee. This is really an information disaster in science. And we all know this, of course. But you could say, okay, there's a lot of information that we have these new technologies. Everything should, in fact, could be relevant and could also be helpful for the good life. I would say no. Unfortunately, that is not the case. There are two problems. First, because of the system of this short cycling and getting in hyper competition and having to making these publications, people are picking topics that are low risk. They take a topic on which gives them the papers in 4 years because they need them to survive. There's a lot of short-term thinking. There's a lot of me-too research. Very small changes, very little novelty in many papers. And second, and that's even worse, poor quality. We are spending too little time on quality control. We are publishing and publishing, but we are not taking the time to take quality control into our system. To show you this is really a shocking slide. Some people have reported from pharmaceutical companies, but also colleagues in clinical epidemiology have reported that if you go and you check on the most promising biomedical research, most of that research doesn't stand the trial, doesn't stand reproducibility, cannot be reproduced by other scientists, even using the same apparatus, mice, reagents, whatever. You can see there's only a very small portion in green. And this has been extremely shocking. In The Lancet last year, a group of 20 colleagues published 8 papers showing that clinical trials were poorly done. Poorly done. You could say, why is that? Why is this system so flawed? In fact, this is not fraud, this is haste. We are all very hasty. We have little time. We have to publish. People are counting our publications, but we don't have time for quality control. We don't take the time. So forget about fraud. These are exceptions. But haste produces waste, and that's our biggest problem. We should avoid the waste. That's also what these authors said. What is the remedy? What should we do? We have to put science back in the context. We have to put science back in society. And you can see the circle around science is broken. It's permeable. So we should all go in and out society, and society should go into the laboratories and should go into the institutes. The patients should talk with the doctors and should sit with the people in the laboratories and discuss what type of science do we need. Is this the right way to go? Of course, they will not set the agenda, but we will set the agenda together. This will be co-creation. This is, of course, a popular word, but this is really co-creation and really a communication. And of course, we should reward academics, investigators, for picking the real topics and spending more time than 4 years. We should change also the system of how to fund and how to give out the monies. We should really have the courage to change the system and say, yes, take 10 years and solve a real problem. And okay, of course it has to be published, but we will not count your publications. You will explain to us what your best publication was all about. ACT UP in the late 80s has shown us the way that this can be a real game changer. The guys from ACT UP really went into the National Institute of Health and they went into our laboratories to discuss with us. And we listened to them and we did better science. And HIV/AIDS has been always seen as a game changer and it can be done for everything. Joep Lange, he was one of the early, inspirational colleagues of mine in Amsterdam, in the Amsterdam cohort studies. And you know, Joep died in the crash of Malaysian Airlines over Ukraine. Joep was one of the people who followed the ACT UP, example, even much further. He saw to it that antiviral therapy came and that HIV became a chronic disease. But he also went on in the late 90s and took the therapy to Africa, where they couldn't afford it. But together with pharmaceutical companies, they worked out a contract that it was an affordable therapy also for sub-Saharan Africa. And that is what science should do. It should also take the science outside the laboratories. It should put it everywhere on the globe where it is needed most. And this, to me, makes it very, very clear. This can be done. This really can be done. But it is a game changer. We have to think about how can we change the system. And of course, it's not only one dean can change it, not only one scientist, not only one patient advocacy group, of not only the people in the Schildersbuurt, in the backwaters of a big city that have poor quality teaching and education. They have to speak up, and we together have to work to change the system. We need a concerted action for transition. And I think it can be done. So my pledge to you today is, go with me, change the system, and don't say, yeah, but no. Go with it and ACT UP. Science in transition can be done. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Frank Miedema. Thank you very much.